From Isolation Studios, it's Richard Krauss.
Welcome everybody to In Isolation With. It's the talk show where we make a connection without actually making contact. I'm Richard Krauss. I hope you're staying healthy, I hope you're staying happy, and I hope that you're staying safe. Now, before we meet my guest, Ian Reid, the Canadian author of the best-selling novel, I'm Thinking of Ending Things, I want to set things up so that you'll know what we're talking about. We cover a lot of ground in this interview, from how his father, a high school English teacher and university lecturer, and his mother and sister, who were also keen readers, influenced his love of storytelling, how rejection is good for an author. We talk about his two memoirs, but the focus is his bestseller, I'm Thinking of Ending Things. Described as a psychological thriller and horror fiction, it's about a young man who takes his girlfriend to see his parents on a remote farm and the disturbing aftermath. It sounds simple, but this is anything but. It's a story of predetermination and free will that bears up to reading and then reading again. It's now also a film directed by Charlie Kaufman and currently playing on Netflix. To give you some context, I thought I'd play some clips of Kaufman and his stars, Jesse Buckley and Toni Collette, talking about the plot.
Oh, God. It's so hard to describe. I don't know if you can describe what this is.
It's about a young man and a young woman who are going on a road trip during a snowstorm to visit his parents, who live in an isolated farmhouse. She's thinking of ending their relationship and he doesn't know. And that's kind of how it starts out.
It is complex and exciting in its ideas, but ultimately it's about a kind of lonely, disconnected guy and deals with issues of loneliness and disconnection and hope for connection and longing and also memory and regret and guilt and all of the things that we grapple with as humans at some point.
It's a trip and it's a kind of, a road trip of memory of yourself and what you've become.
A head trip.
A head trip.
All right, what they said. It's a road trip and it's a head trip, particularly in the film's final 20 minutes or so. Okay, you're up to speed on the story, at least as much of the story as I can tell you without giving anything away. Let's meet Ian Reid, the author of the book. I started this interview by congratulating him on his recent success.
Well, thank you. It's I was just talking to a friend recently who had picked up the book and was talking about it, and having friends be able to, you know, read that book or any of my books, it's a surprising feeling, because especially when I started writing fiction, never really anticipated that I would even be able to find a publisher. You know, I think many things is a fairly weird book. It's unusual. So my hope was just to find a Canadian publisher if I got lucky. There was one. We had a few passes here in Canada and we got one publisher who made an offer. So yeah, it feels kind of surprising that, you know, I still feel surprised that when people react to it, the book is out there. But I'm grateful too. That's what you want as a writer, is people to be reading and reacting. So,
well, let's go back a way. So your father was a high school English teacher, as well as a university lecturer. Your mother and older sister were keen readers. Did that shape your love of storytelling?
I think it did. Yeah. As you say, I grew up, my dad was an English prof and my mom also loved books and two older siblings who were readers. So it was very normal for me to have books around the house, to have, discussions at the dinner table about certain novels and film. And so I think I'm fortunate for that I was kind of presented with those opportunities early on, that it was normal. And I didn't even necessarily come to it until a little bit later. I think because I was the youngest, often the discussion of some of the books were a little bit too advanced for me. So I kind of came to that as a little bit older, but definitely even now when I go back to, my parents live on a small farm, and when I go back there, there's still stacks of old books, and I can find things that, little gems that maybe were my dad's from the 60s I love that. I love doing that. There's always little nooks and crannies and full bookshelves that I can find stuff. So
you did that for CBC for a little while, right? You found unusual arcane books for them.
Exactly. That's actually what brought me back to the Ottawa area. I'd been living in, I kind of put off grad school. I moved to Toronto and was working at CBC. And I pitched an idea to the Ottawa CBC that I could come back there and do a segment on the on radio about old books and used bookstores. Mm-hmm. I sort of just came up with what for me was sort of like my dream job, which was like finding old books, reading them, and then kind of talking about if I thought they were still relevant or maybe they were dated. Or and someone, a producer there, kind of, you know, thankfully liked the idea, and I was so excited. I just sort of left Toronto, moved up to Ottawa, and without realizing that this was really a small thing, that they weren't that, it was going to be, you know, a 5-minute segment at 5:30 in the morning. No one was listening, but I was very excited to do that. And so that's actually what brought me back to Ottawa, and I moved back home and ended up writing my first book at that point. So it was kind of funny how things worked out, and I never had that in my mind, but that's kind of what happened.
I love secondhand bookstores. I've written a few books, and when people sometimes say, oh, I bought your book, but I bought it at a secondhand bookstore, and they're sort of almost embarrassed to tell you that because you're not making any money from it. I'm like, do it. When I was a kid, I had no money. That's
exactly what I had to do. Yes, no, exactly. I've seen a couple times my own book in a secondhand bookstore, and I find that exciting. It means there's another life out there. It means someone maybe read it and had some interpretation of it. Maybe they liked it, maybe they didn't, but now maybe someone else is going to come across that book. And so, like you, I love, even, I mean, again, I find sometimes people tell me sort of apologetically, oh, I read your book, I got it from the library. And I think that's amazing. I love, use the library. So any for me, it's if someone takes the time to read a book I wrote, regardless of how they came across it, if it's audiobook or ebook or libraries, I mean, it's there's so many things to occupy our time now. So it just feels lucky if someone takes the time to read one of yours.
Now, after graduation, you had a variety of jobs. You were a call center employee. You worked in a restaurant. You were an intramural basketball coach. You did home renovations with a friend. What did you learn from all of those things that perhaps you use now?
One thing I think that is that just the idea that when I was living in Toronto, working all those different jobs, it never sort of seemed possible that I would ever be kind of doing what I'm doing now as a job. I was doing those variety of things, and then I would make time. I loved writing. I was getting into the process of writing at that point and really enjoying it. So anytime when I wasn't working, I often found myself at my desk writing little short stories. And so I think something when I reflect on it now is just the idea that that was always going to be what I would be doing. I would be working jobs. And then when I would find the time, I would be kind of writing on the side. And that was just sort of what I had kind of come to accept. So to be able to now do it, as a day to day that I, you know, get to go down to my desk and work, it feels very fortunate and lucky. I often think back to that because, you know, most of those jobs I wasn't particularly good at, and I was really wanting to be spending my time, you know, writing. And I don't know what I would be doing right now if I wasn't, because I would have been making time to do it no matter what. But it's nice to be able to wake up in the morning and kind of have a walk and then go to my desk, and that's sort of my commute, and I can start my work day.
What do you love about it? When you're working, I've done all those jobs. I've worked in bars and restaurants and all that kind of thing. And they're tiring. And at the end of the day,
it's hard work,
going home and collecting your thoughts and getting them down on paper in some kind of coherent way. So what was it that drove you?
I just, you know, for me, the word that I think of is just excitement. It felt exciting to me. I think partially too, it was my coming from my love of reading and my love of movies, as you know, watching movies and stories. But particularly, I think my love of reading and books at that point, I was reading all the time. And the idea for me to actually start writing was new at that point. I didn't really have the ambition, even when I was at university, to write creatively. I liked, you know, I enjoyed writing academically, and my thought at that point was I was going to pursue a career in academics, maybe go to grad school. But once I moved to Toronto and I did start to find myself writing, days I was tired or days I've been working, or it just, to me, always felt exciting to return to these stories. And no one knew what I was doing. It was really just for me. I did send a few off eventually to, you know, literary magazines that most of them, well, in fact, I think all of them were rejected rightfully, that, you know, they weren't very good, but that's, it, you know, in those years I was really trying different things, and just, it was difficult. I mean, that's the thing. It's not to say that I would sit down and it felt easy. Mm-hmm. It just felt exciting. It felt challenging. And I knew that it was sort of something that was going to take me a long time to kind of understand. And I still, that's the thing. I think one of the reasons why I still like to do it is that it still feels that way. It still feels both exciting and challenging. And it's a, I think that blend, that mix is why I want to keep doing it.
The rejection is an important part of all of this, though. I used to have a desk drawer right here that was filled with rejection letters, and I kept them all back when you could get a letter. Now it's just a dismissive email. But
no, I agree.
I kept those, and they drove me somehow. And when you were rejected, it's easy to get downtrodden about it. It's easy to think, okay, well, nobody likes my stuff. You pushed through that, and how?
I think again, I think part of the reason why I kept doing it was because it was the work itself that for me at that time when I was writing those, let's say 2 or 3 years in Toronto, it was really just drawing stuff. It was me in my room, no one asking for stuff. No one was reading it. There was no pressure. So I think in some ways the rejections didn't carry the same weight, and it just allowed me to play around and do stuff. And I was only doing it for my own interest, for my own, writing stuff that for me would be the kind of thing I'd want to read. And I did, I've come across, just like you were saying, you kept some of those letters. I actually kept some of the stories that I've been writing. Right. And boy, that's really something to go back and read. It's really
a humbler, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It is. And I think I'm sure I would always feel that way about anything I write. I could pick up any one of my books and flip through it, and there'll be parts that I'd want to rewrite. And I think I could probably comfortably sort of rewrite one book my whole life, because it's never exactly how you want it.
Yeah.
So things change as you do something for longer, and if you stay with something, but you never, at least in my case, you never feel fully comfortable or that you feel like you have a handle on it. And I think that's part of what makes me want to keep writing, and the combination of getting ideas and then feeling like it's challenging and it's tricky, but then always that underlying sense of excitement that for some reason I still have when I kind of get to my desk.
The art of writing is in the rewriting. That's what I've always thought.
You're absolutely right. I think I've learned that through working closely with editors and, feeling grateful to get to the stage of a project when my editors come on board, and they're, it's such a specific job to have editors. And then you're right. As you go through it, you realize certain things, each draft, how much better it can be, and, taking stuff out, adding stuff, but really, the removal is such a, because initially you think everything's important, and then as you go through it, but rewriting, revising, I think you're right. You learn that as you go. That's such an important part of the process.
I used to have a thing when I first started writing. I had a 2-page spread from an old Rolling Stone magazine, and it was an ad for something. I don't even remember what the ad was for, but it was Kurt Vonnegut Jr.'s tips on how to write well. And it was a picture of him at a desk. And the first one was tell a good story. And then the next 9 were keep it simple.
Yeah. Well, exactly. I think that goes back to, the elements of style and just really, I think, getting out of your own way a little bit. And particularly with nonfiction, I think that kind of stuff is important to remember clarity and trying to make it easier on the person reading it. When you get into fiction, it can get a bit more complicated in a way, because maybe a certain character speaks in a way that's complex or that's wordy, but that's again, part of the fun is trying to do that. But I think keeping it simple, not getting too lost in your own head and your own thoughts, and remembering eventually that someone's going to read this. And I think that's something that I tend not to do so much, is to think about a reader. I like to just think about the work and think about the story, but at some point you do have to recognize that it has to be readable, it has to be coherent. Even if you want to try doing things that are a little bit more, experimental or different, at some point someone's going to have to make sense of it.
Right, which you have. Now, when we look back to the first couple of books, they're memoirs, they're light, they are funny by times. They're a much different feel than recent work. Bird's Choice tells the story of your decision to move back in with your mother and father. And before we talk about the book, I was just wondering that in light of the pandemic, so many people are doing this now. This is something that's happening. Do you have any advice for them?
Yeah, I mean, I think because it came up when One Bird's Choice came out, I think a lot of people would come to readings and ask and tell me that they have done something similar. They were about to go, move in with a relative, or it is so common. And you're right, now particularly it's happening. And I think something that I didn't anticipate when I did that was just how much you can appreciate the people in your family after having some time away, and then being with them at a different stage of your own life. So for me to kind of be around my parents my whole life as a child growing up. Everybody was busy. You're doing your own thing and you're kind of inherently self-obsessed as a child. So to kind of, you know, go away, be at university, be living in Toronto for a number of years, to return then as an adult and to live with them and to have had experiences of my own and to see them and reflect on their relationship and them as people and things that they would have done for me when I was younger that I wouldn't have, it was really nice. And I think that's why the tone of that book is, you know, hopefully kind of gentle and pleasant, because that was sort of my easing into that year, was sort of initially feeling sorry for myself that I had to move back to the farm. And then as the year wore on, I started to really appreciate both the landscape, the small little, you know, 200-year-old farmhouse I grew up in, but also my parents and just how they interacted. And I think that for me is what I would tell people, is just sort of, you know, try and think about the people you're living with and not be just initially frustrated, or because that can happen too, but sort of think about some of the ways that you can interact or some of the things that you can appreciate about them that maybe you wouldn't have even known about if you weren't living there.
The two memoirs were very successful. And then you came out with I'm Thinking of Ending Things Here, which is a very different book. And I would suggest that probably you could have gone on writing memoirs and slice of life stories and books and successfully probably for as long as you would care to do that. Tell me about switching up to writing fiction, for one thing, in this form, and the inherent kind of darkness that comes along with this story. And this is a story that for me is internal. It is creepy. It does not feel like the first two books.
No, I think it is very, I think it's, you know, philosophical. I think more than anything, I'm Thinking of Ending Things is about questions, and questions that for me at that time were quite personal questions I've been thinking about. And I think that's what drew me to write this story, was that I knew I wanted to write fiction for a long time. I read more fiction, but it's also harder for me. It's more challenging than writing nonfiction, where you're just reacting to what's happening. So right. I wanted to try writing nonfiction first. And then when I felt like I was maybe ready to try a novel, this was in my mind, this was an idea that I had that again, I think if I'm going to write anything, it has to feel personal. I have to have a connection to it. Otherwise it's hard to justify, you know, sitting down for a couple of years, for me anyway, and writing it. So I knew I wanted to be something that I would be thinking about seriously, and that meant something to me that felt somehow truthful. And so I just kind of started writing it, and also because I'd never done anything like it. And that's another part of the appeal of writing for me, is to never feel like you're repeating yourself. And so those first two books, I think, although they were about different things, they had a similar tone. And so I really wanted to try something different. And I had, you know, studied some philosophy at university, and I think the content or the ideas of the story that I had in my mind, I thought really connected well to some of the ideas I'd studied in my philosophy courses. And they also, to me, felt aligned with suspense. They were suspenseful to me just thinking about them. And so that, I think, is why I've never really thought of the book as a thriller. And some people call it that. You know, I've seen it in bookstores under the thriller, and that's fine. I like people interpreting it however they want. But for me, it was never a thriller. There are moments of suspense, obviously, but really it's more just a literary novel. It's, as you said, it's internal, and it's really about ideas and questions. And then I love how people will, if they do read it, can interpret the story their own way. And I like asking people who have read it what they think it means. I don't like to tell them what it means for me, because I don't want to influence them, but I've had a variety of different reactions to it.
Yeah, whenever anyone would ask Andy Warhol what his paintings meant, he would always just say, well, what do they mean to you?
Oh, interesting.
That's really all that matters, I suppose.
I really feel that way, yeah, about these books. I like that idea, you know, especially when you think about a novel, it takes hours to read of quiet time, someone sitting alone in a room, focused. They're putting a lot into it. So for me, of course, they then have the authority to say what this book is and what it's about. And it's very personal. Anytime you read a book, it's intimate, it's personal. So for me to say, here's what you should get from this book, seems silly. Why write it, you know, and why take the time to read it? I think that's part of the fun. And I love that as a reader, when I sit down with a book and then I get to, you know, maybe you read the same book and we have two different versions of it. And I think that for me is I like that. I like that a lot.
My boyfriend.
It's snowing.
Winter is coming in.
We have a real connection, a rare and intense attachment. I've never experienced anything like it. I'm thinking of ending things.
Huh?
What?
Did you say something?
I don't think so.
Weird.
The ending is ambiguous in many ways. Was there ever any pushback from the publisher to sort of put a little bit more of a bow on it, or no?
No, thankfully. And I, you know, when we first were submitting it, there, especially in the States, there were a few publishers who seemed interested, but then I think exactly that they were a little concerned about the open, how it was open-ended, and yeah, that was left for interpretation. And I think they would have liked it to be, wrapped up in a more concise way or a more traditional way. And so some of the experimental aspects of the story, they probably were not too fond of. But the publisher I ended up finding, Simon & Schuster in the States, and Allison Callahan, the editor there, really liked that. And so I found the one editor, I think, who really responded to that and who was understood, I think, what I was trying to do and how that in this novel, the whole novel would have been different if we changed the ending. And you know, I didn't know that ending when I started writing, and I didn't have an outline or anything. I had this idea in my head of what I wanted to write about. And I had this, you know, idea of this couple going on a road trip, and I kind of started from there. And as I wrote it, everything kind of came and fell into place. And I'm really grateful. I don't think I would have been able to, I would have rather not published it. Right. Then publish it with a different ending, I think so.
Okay, though. So then Netflix enters the picture, and yeah. You of all the people that I can think of that could have directed this, Charlie Kaufman would be on that list. Absolutely. Maybe, I don't know, David Lynch. Maybe there's a handful of people might have been able to hit the tone that you need to hit with this. And take a book that is very much internal, very much in someone's head, and turn it into a film that is as compelling as the one that Charlie Kaufman made. Were you nervous about that? What would happen? Or are you like Raymond Chandler and say, well, my books aren't ruined. They're right up there on the shelf.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think it's a little bit of both. Although I wasn't nervous, I think that's true. Always the book will always be there, and it's always the book. I think part of the fear about, you know, this was my first time having something adapted, is that you're not sure how it's going to be adapted. Right. And then that's, once people see it, that's what, even if they go back and read the book, they're going to be picturing the film. So, you know, yes, that I think can happen. But in this case, I feel very fortunate because I was a fan of Charlie's before anything ever happened with our project. Mm-hmm. And so when he first approached me, I was just excited to talk to him. I was, you know, thrilled to talk to someone who I admired. And so I never worried at all about that. I never worried about what the adaptation would look like, or, you know, I knew he was going to be the one writing it, and I knew he was going to be the one directing it, and that there would be great people involved and actors. And so it didn't guarantee that I would like it, but I also was very comfortable knowing that it was someone like Charlie doing it. And it was thrilling to actually to go through the process and read the script, and then ultimately seeing the movie. I love it. I think it's unclassifiable. It's bold. And I think it's Netflix making this kind of movie in 2020, I think is a good sign, you know, and allowing someone like Charlie to do this, I really appreciate what they've done.
I think so too. You know, as the theaters have increasingly become the realm of superhero movies, and nothing wrong with them, but they're a different, they're a different kind of thing, right?
That's right.
Movies like this need a home. And I think Netflix stepping out and doing something that is remarkable, because I will tell you, the last 20 minutes of this movie, and this gives nothing away, is as trippy as anything I've seen on film for a very long time.
Exactly. I agree. It's really unlike, you're right. It's unlike anything else I've seen. And I think also too, just the, at moments it's funny, at moments it's really sad, at moments it's a little bit unsettling. I find it quite moving, and, you know, being able to hit all those beats and notes, I think also says something about the acting. And I think the acting is really quite remarkable too. Again, going into it, I was expecting that when the cast was put together, but to actually, you know, see them and see the finished product, I look forward to people reacting to the actors, and I think, just because, again, it's a different kind of piece, and I think they all did really well.
Essentially, there's four leads in this. Of all of them, Jessie Buckley is probably the name that not a lot of people know.
Yeah,
but she is remarkable.
She's remarkable.
She is remarkable. She made a film, I think it was called Little Bird, where she played a singer-songwriter in Scotland who desperately wanted to be a country singer. That's the first time that I saw her. Right. And I thought to myself, she is someone to look out for.
No, she, I mean, I really think she is a star, you know, and you can kind of see it in this movie, what she portrays, how she does it. And right from the beginning, I mean, it's a challenging shoot, I think. And, she's really memorable. And I think that's going to be one of the things that really stands out with this movie is people coming to see her and really appreciating her. And I'm really excited to see what she does next too, because she's so talented.
Those scenes in the car, you know, as they're driving it feels like, and I wasn't looking at my watch, but it felt like some of them are 15 minutes long and it's the two of them talking and some of it's internal and some of it's not.
That's right.
And
that's
yet it's all very interesting. It all, all captures you.
And how different it is from, you know, there's basically the car ride there and then the car ride back and they're very different, you know?
Well, and I love that Kaufman took his time to show us that though.
Yeah.
I think that's right. A lot of other directors may have wanted to condense that a little bit or give you sort of broader strokes of what was happening between them at the time. And he doesn't. He takes the time to do it.
Yeah,
and that's why I think the payoff much later in the film is so much bigger than it
might
have been.
So much more meaningful. No, you're right. I think that there's a lot of little unusual things I think about this movie, which is why to me it kind of, in some ways I thought about this writing the book, sort of demands a second or third viewing and is a different experience. And that was in my mind writing the book too. And that's why the book is so short. And why, you know, going back to what you were saying about revising, a lot of what the revising I did was to remove stuff because I wanted people to feel it got to the end. Well, it's not so daunting to start it over. If it was a 400 or 500 page book, they might not want to, but 200 page book, you can kind of, and then hopefully it was going to be a totally different experience the second time. And I do think the movie's like that as well. I've seen it a few times and it's different each time.
Yeah, I'm sure there's people out there that have read War and Peace more than once. But I don't know many of them.
No, I don't know many of them either. It's a good book, but that's,
Well, congratulations on everything, the movie, the books, and whatever it is that you're working on now. I'm sure we'll get a chance to see it the next year or so. And thanks for taking the time to do this.
Well, thank you very much. I really appreciate it. Nice to talk to you.
People like to think of themselves as points moving through time. But I think it's the opposite. We're stationary and time passes through us, blowing like cold wind. Maybe this is how it was always going to end.
That was my interview with Ian Reid. Find his books, including his latest, a philosophical mind bender called Foe. And of course, I'm Thinking About Ending Things, wherever you buy fine books. Also, check out the movie on Netflix. That's it for today. My thanks to Ian Reid for his time. But most of all, as always, my biggest thanks goes to you for watching. I'm Richard Krause. Stay happy, stay healthy, stay safe, and we'll talk again soon.